the FBI is positive that North Korea hacked Sony, Intel's PC on a stick, and Father Robert Ballecer is live from CES, the CES floor, this time with more tech goodies for us. Tech News Tonight is next. What?
This is Twit.
This is Tech News Tonight, episode 248 for Wednesday, January 7th, 2015. This episode is brought to you by Lynda.com. Invest in yourself for 2015 with Lynda.com, which has thousands of courses to help you learn tech, business, and creative skills. For a free 10-day trial, visit lynda.com/TN2. That's lynda.com/TN and the number 2. Well, hello, everyone. I'm Sarah Lane, and let's get right into our tech feed for the day. The Federal Bureau of Investigation says that there is no doubt that the North Korean government was indeed behind the massive network attack on Sony that was discovered back in November. At the International Conference on Cybersecurity in New York today, FBI Director James B. Comey said that people in internet security who have been vocal about doubting that North Korea is responsible don't have all the information that he does. For example, a few IP addresses that could be traced directly back to North Korea is one example. Mr. Comey also said that the Guardians of Peace, that's the group who has claimed responsibility for the Sony attack, used proxy servers to disguise the trail of evidence, but sometimes they got sloppy. The government has said that the attack was at least partly due to Sony's film The Interview that included a fictional assassination of the North Korean leader Kim Jong-un. Now, as for the fate of the film The Interview, Sony initially pulled its Christmas Day release due in part to movie theaters' fears of ongoing attacks, but then partially reversed that decision and showed the film to a much smaller number of theaters after public and political pressure, President Obama included. Online services like YouTube and iTunes joined in on the interview's distribution. And yesterday, CNN reported that the comedy had been rented or bought 4.3 million times between its online release of Christmas Eve through January 4th. Sony also announced that the movie had pulled in $31 million in streaming revenues, the studio's top performing movie online ever. Now, you might say, well, doesn't it cost a lot of money to make movies? Even if The Interview cost about $44 million, that's what it has been set as to make, and then another additional $35 million to market, meaning that it wouldn't have made a profit, the movie also hasn't been released outside of North America yet, so there might be some money to make yet. Lots of news coming out of Washington today. The Federal Communications Commission Chairman Tom Wheeler has announced that his office will vote on an official proposal for net neutrality on February 26th after circulating to his fellow commissioners by the 5th. Back in November, President Obama urged the FCC to classify internet traffic under Title II, although Wheeler suggests that the FCC might take more of a hybrid approach to the issue. He didn't provide any specifics, but this approach could use stricter Title II regulation on the parts of the internet that connect content providers without applying that same regulation to the last leg of the internet that connects to consumers' homes. Well, you know, since we're talking about the government, let's give a little TN2 love to another piece of government, the Federal Trade Commission, which is in the news today as well. Yelp has announced on its official blog that the FTC had concluded an inquiry into the company that started last year in response to complaints over its business practices. Yelp says that it's been informed the FTC will not be taking any action against it after looking into the company's recommendation software, communication with other businesses, advertising programs, and rating system. This is the second time that the FTC has looked into Yelp's advertising practices and ended its inquiry without further action. All right, I promised you the CES show floor, and that's what I'm going to give you. And joining us now on the show floor is Father Robert Ballecer. How's it going? And how are those, you know, I said yesterday I made a joke about blisters, but it might not be a joke at this point.
Sarah, my dogs are barking. That's right. We've been walking up and down this convention center. It's ridiculous.
So, all right, we talked a little bit yesterday about just kind of some of the trends that you had noticed. This still being, we're about midweek into the flurry of CES news and all the electronics that you're getting your hands on and absorbing specs for. Let's talk a little bit about self-driving cars today. We touched on it a bit yesterday. You said Mercedes had a beautiful model. Audi was doing some interesting stuff. Self-driving cars, this is something that Google really put into the forefront recently. We now realize that car manufacturers do not want to be left in the dust. They are working on their own versions of self-driving cars. What is the general consensus of how far out we are, and what's the most interesting technology that you've seen so far?
That's a very interesting question, because if you looked at the main example of the self-driving car at CES, you would probably look at the Mercedes. It was based on the F015 chassis. It's a beautiful car, prototype, but the whole idea was, because it looks so futuristic, you weren't going to see it until 2023, 2025. Now, let's step forward. Go past Mercedes and you see Audi. Audi built self-driving cars out of their A7 and RS7 models. These are existing cars that you can buy right now. They added a few sensors and they added some computers into the back to make it be able to drive from San Francisco to Las Vegas with no driver. There was a journalist sitting behind the wheel, but he never touched it as it was going. You go from that to Volkswagen. Today we took a look at Volkswagen's technology. They included it on their e-Golf. Now here's the thing. You can buy this car today. Now, it's not a self-driving car in the truest sense, like the Audi or the Mercedes or even the BMW. But what it will do is it will park itself, and it's an electronic car that knows where the chargers are. So you push a single button, and it will drive itself to a charger. And then when it's ready, it will alert you on your mobile, and you can say, come back. Now, the wonderful thing about that is all those sensors were already included in the car. All they had to do was write some software. So when people ask, how close are we to self-driving cars, the answer is really variable. It depends on what you mean by self-driving car, what's your threshold for what makes a car self-driving, and really where you live in the world. Because if you live in Europe right now, you can buy a self-driving VW.
You mentioned yesterday that the idea of perhaps not having a car that was completely self-driving, but something that could, park in a parking lot for you in a crowded grocery market parking lot. That's actually an issue I have all the time at the grocery store that I go to. Or even parallel parking in a better way, not having to be in the car would be awesome. And it does matter where you are. Do you live in an urban area? Do you have a long commute? Is it a rural area? How do these manufacturers work with each other so that in, let's say, 5 years down the road, you with your Golf and me with my Audi are not at odds with each other in that crowded grocery store parking lot?
That's a great question, because what you want is to build out the infrastructure. And that's only going to happen if all the automotive manufacturers come together and say, we can agree on a standard, we can agree on a collision avoidance system, we can agree on a way to navigate so that our cars aren't going to be self-driving into each other. We're not quite seeing that yet. But with the release of these cars at CES, specifically the Audi and the VW, I think what we will have is we'll have an impetus. The other car manufacturers are going to feel pressured. You're going to see Ford, you're going to see GM saying, we got to jump on this. Well, why don't we just take the system that they've got in VW's e-Golf, because we've got those same sensors in our car. I think that's the edge. That's what we're going to see. Not a tacit agreement, but sort of the passive, we want to get into this game. You've got the technology. We're going to license it from you.
You know, at CES, it's all about the technology. Everybody's showing off the best of the best, and if it looks great, that's even better. You know, I'm referring to that Mercedes car, but there are obviously the whispers that regulation can really put the damper on this self-driving technology going forward. How much do you hear from where you are on the show floor of people kind of talking about, well, this all looks nice and good, but California will never let us do it?
That's actually huge. We were at the VW demo station outside in the front of CES, and we posed that question. We asked, well, what do you have to do to be able to prove that your car is safe? Because ultimately what it comes down to is programming every possible scenario, and it's not possible to program every possible scenario. You never know what strange thing is going to happen that might trigger the wrong response. Now, here's the funny thing. Europe is actually our test case. Because these cars are already approved in Europe, because you can already buy a self-driving VW e-Golf in Europe, that's gonna sort of shake out some of the biggest problem cases. And I think by the time we see them on U.S. roads. These self-driving cars will have a couple of years under their belt where they can say, yeah, you know what, there might be some outliers as far as danger situations are concerned, but we've dealt with all of the major things. I think once we can tell people, it's just like convincing them that they should give up their privacy on Facebook. Once we can convince them that it's worth it to take the risk to have these self-driving cars, like, for example, a net decrease of accidents, then it's not so much a legislative hurdle as it is a mindshare hurdle.
Father Robert Ballecer hosts many shows here on the Twit Network, This Week in Enterprise Tech, Coding 101, Know How, and the newest show, Padres Corner, which airs on Fridays. And he was good enough to take one for the team and do all of the heavy walking at CES the entire week. Thanks so much, Padre, and have fun.
Thanks, Sarah. Take care.
All right, coming up on TN2, Intel's new PC on a stick. It's not exactly what it sounds like, but we'll explain it. And Monster sues Apple, or people who now work for Apple, over that Beats deal. We'll have more details on that. But first, this episode of Tech News Tonight is brought to you by Lynda.com. We love Lynda.com because it's used by millions of people all over the world to help them learn. 4,500 courses on topics like web development or photography, visual design. I don't know anything about that, but I sure would like to. Many facets of business, software training. Maybe you've just never been good with spreadsheets. Maybe you're ready to tackle Photoshop. If you're looking to sharpen coding skills, or maybe you'd like to put together your first big app and you want to design it yourself. Lynda.com has all sorts of courses like that. They range from programming on iOS to simple Android development tools, even something called the Code Clinic. That's a series where each month Lynda.com issues a code challenge, and then authors help with their solutions using different programming languages, and you learn a lot in the process. You might just have a few minutes, maybe a few minutes a day, maybe even just a few minutes a week. Maybe you've got all the time in the world. Maybe you're ready to learn full time. Each course is structured so you can learn at your own pace, from start to finish, where you can jump around. Of course, Lynda.com courses are taught by the people who know this stuff the best. They are professionals. They are experts at the top of their field. It's 2015. You might have a resolution to learn something new, and Lynda.com is the place to do it. You can also sign up for a free 10-day trial to Lynda.com right now just by visiting lynda.com/TN2. That's lynda.com/TN2. Unlimited access to every course. I said 4,500. Those are all at your fingertips, including access on your iOS or Android device. Hey, if you've got a long commute, you don't need to be in front of your computer. You can access lynda.com from anywhere. Plus, new courses are added each week. lynda.com/TN2 and try it free for 10 days. We challenge you to learn something new in 2015, and we thank Lynda for their support of Tech News Tonight. On to a few more stories that we're following today. Intel has showed off all sorts of electronics at CES this week, computers, laptops, you name it. But something sort of sticks out to us, the Compute Stick. See what I did there? It's an actual PC on a stick that will ship with either Windows 8.1 or Linux pre-installed, so you got a choice. Now, like media sticks, like the Amazon Fire TV Stick, for example, Intel's Compute Stick can handle media streaming. It's got a HDMI port, but also additional computing with its Bay Trail processor. Now, the Windows version has 2 gigs of RAM and 32 gigs of flash storage, and it'll run $149. The Linux version's a little smaller. It has 1 gig of RAM and 8 gigs of storage, but it'll only run $89. Both will ship this spring. So it's not so much a stick. It's more of a brick, but, you know, I like the stick thing. Audio equipment maker Monster and its CEO Noel Lee are suing Apple-owned Beats Electronics, along with Beats co-founders Jimmy Iovine and Dr. Dre, plus Taiwanese smartphone maker HTC, alleging that Monster was duped out of a deal with Beats before the company was sold to Apple for $3.2 billion last year. So it was a big deal. So here are the details. Monster claims that Beats fraudulently acquired the Beats by Dr. Dre line of headphones through what it calls a sham transaction with HTC. Now, HTC agreed to purchase a 51% stake in Beats for $300 million way back in 2011. The complaint says that Beats then repurchased 25.5% of its own shares from HTC less than a month after that deal was done, so that Beats could end its relationship with Monster over change of ownership clause. Monster says that it developed, it manufactured, and it distributed the headphones in exchange for the licensing rights to the Beats brand and marketing. They feel like they got caught out of all the good stuff. Now, 8 months before Apple bought Beats, Monster CEO Noel Lee sold his remaining shares in Beats and now alleges that he sold the shares after being misled by a board member that no liquidity event was on the horizon. So there's a lot of he said, she said. Hopefully it'll all come out in court pretty soon. Apple can't get away from these lawsuits, even though it's actually not a defendant in the suit, only Beats. All right, appropriately named site Nice Kicks talks about shoes. Pretty cool website. Is reporting that Nike is working on technology, rather, to replicate the self-lacing shoes that Marty McFly wore in the movie Back to the Future Part 2. Which is not as good as the first movie, but you know, you remember it, right? It took place in 2015, so there's a lot of buzz around, hey, how did they get these certain things right and wrong about 2015 so far? Nike says that it's working as hard as possible to deliver the Nike Mag with power laces sometime this year. In fact, they promised this about a year ago. So if we're saying sometime in 2015, that could be tomorrow or basically in a year from now. And finally, if I say the word selfie, you probably know that I mean a self-portrait taken with a smartphone, right? Everybody knows what selfie is, but what if I say a belfie? Any guesses? No? Belfie? Okay, I'll just tell you. It's a selfie stick for your butt. Yeah, the creators of Selfie Happy Social Network on.com, I have never been there, but maybe you have, apparently invented the belfie to finally, quote, make it easy to take pics of your bum in any angle. Now, guess how much that you would have to spend if you would like this belfie? That would be $79.99. And it's currently sold out. And I just don't know what's happening with the world, so whatever. That's it for this edition of Tech News Tonight. Subscribe to the show at twit.tv/TN2. You can write us at tn2@twit.tv. And of course, you can watch live every weekday at 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern. Don't miss our morning news program. That's Tech News Today, tomorrow and every weekday at 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern. Hope you can catch both. I'm Sarah Lane, and thanks for watching.
Bandwidth for Tech News Tonight is brought to you by CashFly.com.